This week, our castaway is the actress, entertainer, and authoress, Diana Dawes. Diana, welcome ashore.
Thank you.
Do you play discs a lot?
I don't, actually, no. I'd love to be able to say yes, but I don't. I used to a great deal because I found that in those days I needed background music all the time to what I was doing. Now, I suppose it's because I've got a teenage son and many young people have actually worked for me as nannies and whatever, you know, in the last few years. And I find it very strange. Perhaps I was exactly the same, but everything they do, including the gardener, has to be done with a transistor radio blaring out ear-splitting noise, regardless of what sort of music it is. And I just love the peace and quiet of not having that sound. So I don't play records as much as I used to.
Well, you've got only eight on the island and you don't have to play them except when you feel like
it. Oh, how lovely.
What's the first one?
Well, I'm an optimist, you see, so therefore I would be looking on the bright side and hoping that somebody was going to come and rescue me. One of my favourite male singers is Tony Bennett. I've had the pleasure of working with him in strange places like South America. And so this record, one of hundreds he's sung, "The Best Is Yet to Come," I think is an optimistic message from someone like Tony Bennett.
Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started to hum. Still, it's a real good bet, the best is yet to come.
Tony Bennett, "The Best Is Yet to Come." Diana, you were born in Swindon, Wiltshire. Tell me about your parents. Were they interested in the theatre, in music?
Well, they were both very interested in it. My father was an extremely talented pianist who could have become professional and was offered many times to actually go into concert and to accompany well-known singers of the time. But he was a very sensible man and he preferred a secure, comfortable, quiet existence in Swindon, which was then a fairly small town. And not so anymore, I'm afraid. My mother trained as a singer, not professionally, again, and they both did a great deal of amateur theatricals in Swindon. My mother, I think, had many dreams of being all sorts of things in her life, and as I was an only child, and I wasn't born until she was 42, I think she lived out a lot of her fantasies in me. She was a great cinema fan. She took me to the cinema when I was three.
Really?
And that's where my first love of films and the lure of Hollywood started. In fact, Hollywood has a great deal to answer for because I actually thought people behaved like they did on the screen in Hollywood. I mean, I grew up with this sort of silly romantic idea that if a man took you out for the evening, apart from buying you an orchid to pin on your dress and buying you champagne and caviar, he actually probably took you home and did a tap dance around the lamppost or sang you a song in the moonlight.
Have you never found that to happen?
No. Most decidedly no.
Right, so you decided almost at the age of three that was for you.
Oh yes, I wanted to be a film star from that moment, and I was very much encouraged by my mother, who, as I say, obviously would like to have done all sorts of things in that direction herself, but never could.
You won medals for elocution very early on.
Yes, I did, yes. And when I was 13, I wasn't getting very far at school. And my father, who'd been absolutely set against me ever going anywhere near the theatre because he said he'd seen too much of it, finally relented and allowed me to start attending the London Academy of Music and Dramatic Art, where I used to go once a week for an acting lesson. And then when I was 14, I came to live in London full-time and lived at a very prim and proper building, the YWCA, and attended the London Academy. And I was there for about 2 years.
As a child, I believe you had entertained the troops during the last year of the war.
That's right, yes. Well, my father being a pianist, you see, during the course of the war, he was called upon to organise shows for troops who were billeted on army sites and under canvas all around Swindon. And there were quite a few talented artists in Swindon, amateur ones, of course. Mm. But if occasionally one of them fell ill, or they couldn't do it. I was roped in at the last minute to give the troops my version of any Shirley Temple song that happened to be around at the time, like The Good Ship Lollipop. Oh, and my, Miss Your Apple Pie. That wasn't one of Shirley's, but it was a great favourite with the troops in those days. And sometimes I'd throw in a recitation or two just for good measure.
Right, but you've moved on to Lambda, the London Academy. What was the first professional job you did?
When I was 14, I was taking my silver medal for acting, I think. We used to do acting exams at the end of every term. And the adjudicator was a film casting director called Eric Lapine Smith. And he not only awarded me my silver medal, but he said that he had a small part that I could play in a film called The Shop at Sly Corner, which had been a famous stage play. Oscar Homolka was the star of it. He said, but for goodness sake, don't tell the director that you're only 14 because it's the part of the Spiv's girlfriend. There you are, that dates it's Spiv. We don't yes. hear about them. They were wide boys or gangsters. And he said, it's his girlfriend. And he said, if I go back and tell him that you're only 14, he said, I've seen you act. I know you can do it. But if I tell him you're only 14, he'll say, ridiculous, because girls of 14 were not as advanced as they are today, and he would have just been laughed out of the studio, and so would I. So we kept it a secret until I'd finished the film, and then we told the director, who couldn't believe it.
And you were doing some photographic modelling for pocket money while you were at Lambda.
Yes, I used to be paid a guinea an hour by a very respectable establishment called the Camera Club in London. And I used to do that in the evenings when I wasn't studying. And, of course, I kept going back to Lambda when I wasn't filming, which was most of the time, because the parts that I received after the Shop at Sly Corner were very small ones. I did a couple more. I acquired an agent. And, of course, by the time I was 15 years old, I was put under contract to the J. Arthur Rank Organization for 10 years because I'd auditioned and done a screen test for a film which was being made by David Lean called Oliver Twist.
Yes.
And I got the part, and so the Rank contract was also part of the deal.
Let's have your second record. What's that?
That is a marvellous song from the show Annie, which I confess I haven't seen. But I think this song, the way it's sung by any child, just pulls the heartstrings of any adult. It certainly does mine. And although I was never a child like Annie, it sort of takes me back to my childhood.
The sun will come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come what may, tomorrow, tomorrow, I love you. Tomorrow, you're always a day away. Tomorrow, tomorrow, I love you. Tomorrow, you're always a day.
A song from Annie, sung by Anne-Marie Guatkin. Now, Diana, you were a young contract artist with a huge Rank organisation. Did that mean you had to go to what the press called the charm school?
Yes, well, when we were not actually filming, we were required to attend what was originally called the Company of Youth. In other words, they were all Mr. Rank's young starlets, including boys, who were under contract to the Rank organisation, and who were supposed to be taught at that school to act and do all the things that I had just spent 2 years at Lambda doing. So I found it a dreadful waste of time.
Now, as a starlet, you made a whole series of films with Jack Warner and Kathleen Harrison and Petula Clark. What, the Something Family?
The Huggett family, yes.
That's it.
Yes, yes. I played the naughty niece.
What was the first film in which you played a leading part?
That was a film called Diamond City. I was 17, and I'd made countless films by then for Rank, and other companies, of course, because we were hired out to other companies. And Gene Kent was set to star in this film, which is all about the diamond rush of 1880 or 1890 or something in South Africa, playing the saloon bar belle who was pretty old and hard-bitten. Well, Gene Kent suddenly decided she'd had enough of playing these sort of parts, and so she announced that she wasn't going to do it so quickly. Rather the way my father used to sort of grab me at the last moment when somebody fell out on those troupe concerts. They looked around and quickly thought, now who can we get to play this? But, oh, of course it has to be Diana Dawes because she plays all the bad girls. So in I went, looking as though I was dressed in my mother's clothes with my hair piled up high because it was a sort of period piece, you know. And when I say my mother's clothes, I mean these long dresses. I mean, I was 17 and I was trying to play some sort of hard
hard-bitten saloon floozy of 35 at least, you know. But it was my first starring role, yes. And I had the excitement of seeing my name up in lights in Piccadilly when the film came out. It wasn't a particularly good film, but I was on my way to the stars.
Yes, they were good days, but the British film business was running into a serious slump, wasn't it?
Yes, it was coming up to around about 1950. And for some reason, the halcyon days of the British film industry, which had been lifted up by J. Arthur Rank and created into a marvellous industry, were suddenly something like 18 million in the red. And I, along with most of the other Rank contract artists, were told that we were being made redundant. You know, films were not being made, and they just had to cut back. And so suddenly at 18, I was a has-been before I'd been anywhere.
A good point, I think, to break off for record number three.
Well, this was a lady who was singing at around that time and is still singing, and I think is quite unique, and that's Peggy Lee. She's written many marvellous songs, and I thought that she'd written this particular one that I chose, but I since find out that she hasn't. It doesn't matter. I love the song, and I love her. I always have. Peggy Lee singing Come Back to Me.
Hear my voice where you are. Take a train. Steal a car, hop a freight, grab a stop, come back to me. Catch a plane, catch a breeze, on your hands, on your knees, swim or fly, only please, come back to me.
Peggy Lee singing Come Back to Me, and I see it says on the sleeve that the number was written by Burton Lane and Alan Lerner, and it's from the show On a Clear Day You Can See Forever. So, the film industry collapsed. You'd married a bright and rather erratic young man named Dennis Hamilton, and he set out to promote you, to give you a big star build-up. He certainly got you in the newspapers.
Oh, yes. He announced that he was going to build me into the biggest female star that Britain had ever seen, that I was going to be their number one blonde sex symbol in the same way that we'd had all the American blonde sex symbols up until that time. And he also said he was going to make me into a female Errol Flynn. I wasn't too keen on that idea, you know, always getting into scrapes and getting my name in the paper. I was a little worried as to what my parents would feel about that, living in Swindon. Anyway, there wasn't very much I could say or do because he was an extremely dominant, vibrant personality. And he set about doing just that, making me into a household word. We hadn't very much money. In fact, we had none when we first got married. And Dennis set about weaving this publicity spell in between films that he managed to get for me, whereby we were supposed to have vast property and wealth and live in great luxury in the way that Hollywood stars lived. And of course, England at that time in the early 50s was still very much suffering from the hangover of the war. Things were still rather austere. In fact, up until 1952, there were still ration books for food.
Yes, indeed.
So all this sudden talk about a blonde who'd sort of popped up, although people had known me as Diana Dawes, as Starlet with Rank and so on, suddenly this blonde sex symbol who lived in great splendour and piloted herself to her own film premieres in her own plane and all this nonsense, of course, it just caught on. It was escapism and the public lapped it up.
One good thing that came out of that period was your appearance in a West End review, Rendezvous.
Ah, yes. That turned the tide for me, really. That was in 1952. I'd never done a review before. It was great fun. And the show itself was not particularly successful, but I scored an incredible success personally in it. And for a while, tasted the sweet smell of success. I had London at my feet, and it actually rejuvenated my career and was, in a way, because of various things that followed it, plus Dennis's ingenuity, the result of me attaining enormous star status and that second rank contract.
Yeah.
For one picture a year. It was a vastly different one from my Starlet contract.
Now, you made some serious films, two or three.
Yes.
The Week and the Wicked.
The Week and the Wicked was all about a women's prison. Glynis Johns was the star. And the lady that wrote that, Joan Henry, whilst we were doing it in 1953, was busy writing another film, which was all about a woman who'd been condemned to death. And the film took place in the death cell. and she was subsequently hanged. And she wrote this with me in mind, and Yield to the Night was the film.
That's right.
And I seized the opportunity to play that part with both hands because it was the first time in all this blonde glamour image and all the fun that had been going on and so on that I had been given a chance to act. Prior to that, I was chosen by Sir Carol Reed to play the lead in A Kid for Two Farthings, and that was the film which I think was so artistic and so beautiful, and people still speak of it fondly to this day. And indeed, as a result of A Kid for Two Farthings, that year I was the only woman in the top 10 box office stars in this country. So they were two monumental film successes for me.
Yes, indeed. Very different to your newspaper image.
Yes, yes.
Record number four.
Well, this is a classic piece by one of my favourite classic composers, Sibelius. I never really know which part of the symphony, or indeed which symphony it is. I think it's Symphony No. 2. But I remember that when Dennis and I were first starting out in our marriage together, and we had no money, and he was promising to make me that big star, it was one of the pieces of classical music that we used to play, and it's always been a favourite of mine.
An excerpt from the Sibelius Second Symphony in D, Paavo Berglund conducting the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra. When did you go to the United States for the first time? When did Hollywood beckon?
In 1956. I sat around after Yield to the Night had been acclaimed by press, public and everybody else, waiting for another wonderful part like that to be offered, and nothing came. And finally, I received an offer to go to Hollywood. And I thought, well, I mean, I'd always wanted to go. It had always been my ultimate ambition to go there. And it wasn't a particularly good script I went over to do. It was a comedy called I Married a Woman with a comedian who at the time was the hottest thing in America, but never really made it over here, a guy called George Gobel.
Yes.
And I did the film, and I followed it up with a dramatic film called The Unholy Wife with Rod Steiger, which was much more appealing to me. But I never really attained the success in Hollywood that I had managed to achieve over here. And the simple reason was that there was a lady called Marilyn Monroe. No one in America had ever seen anything that I had done, and they all thought that I was some British blonde who'd copied Marilyn Monroe and jumped onto that publicity bandwagon. So this made it very frustrating for me and very difficult.
And, of course, you had marital troubles, which was making your life even more complicated.
That didn't help. No, that certainly didn't help.
Yeah.
I went back to Hollywood again in 1960 with my second husband, who was known over here as Dickie Dawson, who was a comedian, who is now, I may say, the biggest television daytime host in America. But, of course, he was an unknown comedian then. We went back because I was working in Las Vegas in cabaret, because at that point, you know, I had actually started doing a cabaret act in England. And I worked in Las Vegas for 10 weeks. And then we bought a house and I made a few films over there. One of my sons was born there.
Yes.
And I lived in Hollywood for 4.5 years until about 1964. But then again, I never really got over this thing of wanting to come back to England. My then husband loved it there. It was a great climate for the children to grow up in. And we had a beautiful house in Beverly Hills, but I still had to work all over the world in order to pay the bills, because at that point he had not managed to obtain any work there at all. and I was obliged to leave the two boys in Hollywood with him and a nanny whilst I did so. I never, ever went back there to live. The marriage floundered.
Yes.
I was working over here, which pleased me from a work point of view, but of course the sacrifice that I made as far as my children was concerned is something that I can never, ever...
Yes, of course. They grew up in California. They're both in show business now.
Yes, they are. One of them, the oldest one, Mark, still lives in Hollywood and works with his father on the television program and has his own pop group. And the younger one, Gary, who is now 19, announced 2.5 years ago that he was going to come back and live here with me, which is very, very comforting for me, having lost them both all those years. And he is a musician, plays piano, guitar, and hopefully will do all kinds of things musically.
Record number 5.
Well, Johnny Mathis has always been a great favourite of mine, and I remember those early days in Hollywood in the 60s when I was living there. And I was listening to Johnny Mathis then, and I'm still listening to him and loving him. And well, it's a different backcloth of my life now, but he's still the same. And this is one of the many songs he's recorded, which I love. It's called The Look of Love.
The look of love is in your eyes, a look your smile can't disguise, the look of love.
Johnny Mathis, The Look of Love. I've been reading your book, Diana. Doors by Diana. Life certainly hasn't been easy for you. Money troubles, marital troubles, all sorts of complications, but you've battled your way through, and it's a very hopeful and exciting book.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad you see it that way, because I wrote 2 other books, and they were not autobiographies, obviously, but they were just aimed at making people laugh and amusing everybody with stories and behind-the-scenes anecdotes of what goes on. In fact, the sort of things that one would like to write in an autobiography, but there really isn't space for it all. And then one day, a girlfriend of mine who had been watching me on television doing some light-hearted musical program said, you know, people see you on television and you look glamorous and you're smiling and you look as though you haven't a care in the world, and they all think what a fabulous life she must lead. And if they only knew what really goes on and what has happened. And it was at a particularly traumatic and bad time of my life that she said this a couple of years ago. And I suddenly thought, well, that is the trigger. That is the thing that has made me now realize that I should write the personal story of myself, if one wants to call it an autobiography, by all means. But it is a soul-searching and, I hope, completely honest look at myself and my life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm very gratified that you should say what you've just said.
What have been the career highlights in recent years? A few years ago, you had a straight play success with 3 Months Gone.
Yes. Well, my husband, Alan Lake, and I were offered this play. In fact, he was offered it first. And then they asked him if I would read the script with a view to playing Mrs. Hanker, which is a marvellous part. And in short, we opened at the Royal Court Theatre in early 1970. It was an overnight success, and it transferred to the Duchess Theatre, where it ran for the rest of that year. And suddenly, from having had a very bad career time in the late 60s, where I literally was down to going around doing cabaret and working men's clubs and cashing in on a screen name that had once been great, I suddenly opened up a whole new decade for myself in character roles. It's been a marvellous situation for me, really. It's been a rebirth once again of my career. I've had a few rebirths of my career, actually. The 70s, personally for me, were a ghastly time, but professionally, they did open up a whole new decade, and one which I think and hope will go on until the day I die, because, you see, you can always go on playing character roles. You can't continue playing blonde glamour girls.
It's time we had another record. What next?
Oh, well, this is a very sad piece of music, which I've always been rather partial to. It's by Ravel, and it's Pavan pour un infante defunte.
Pavane pour un enfant défunt by Ravel, the Concertgebouw Orchestra of Amsterdam, conducted by Bernard Haitink. What are you up to at the moment, Diana?
Well, I'm doing literally everything, because not only do I play character parts on television and in films, but I'm now very busy doing cabaret, which is completely at the other end of the scale. I write books, I write a column for a newspaper, I do after-dinner speeches and personal appearances. And in fact, after 35 years in show business, I have just made Top of the Pops, because I did a video film in connection with Adam Ant's latest record, Prince Charming, which went to number one on Top of the Pops. It was great fun to do. The producer rang me up one day and said Adam had always been a great fan of mine, and they wanted me to play his fairy godmother in this little video film. And so there I was, on Top of the Pops.
Record number seven.
This is a piece of music called Valse Triste. My father used to play this on the piano, and I remember, apart from the fact that I liked the melody, because once again, I suppose a little bit like the last record we had, which is, it has a sad, wistful quality. I think the story, unless I'm very much mistaken, is about a woman who dies and she dances with her son around this ballroom for the last time before she dies in his arms.
Sibelius again, Valse Triste by the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Herbert von Karajan.
I do seem to lean towards Sibelius, don't I?
Well, 2 out of 8. Let's deal with the material side of surviving on a desert island. Could you build a shelter?
Yes, I'm sure I would be able to do that, because I'm very good physically working at things. I would have made a marvellous domestic cleaner, you know, if I hadn't been Diana Dawe's actress. I rush around my house and I'm always cleaning and tidying up. So I'm sure that I would have the sense to build a shelter to protect myself from the elements.
What about food? Ever done any fishing?
No. Now, that's really where I would come unstuck, because, you see, I should be fancying all sorts of wonderful dishes, and there's no way I'd eat, because I wouldn't last 5 minutes.
Are you a good cook?
I am a good cook, but plain food, of course.
Plain food, well, that's all you
have, for
heaven's sake.
Greatest gravy maker in the world, you see, but how could you make gravy on a desert island?
Oh, there are coconuts and
coconut gravy.
Would you try to escape?
If I could, yes. Yes, I would. I don't know how I'd manage to do it, unless, of course, I really had got clever and was able to make a raft, which was seagoing. Yes, I would try and escape.
Record number 8.
This song, The Way We Were, was from a film called The Way We Were with Barbara Streisand, which I thought was a beautiful film. I love Barbara Streisand singing this song. In fact, I love anyone who sings this song because it has such nostalgic feelings for me, and indeed I do it myself in my own cabaret act, interwoven with another song called My Way, which of course has been done to death by everybody, but I think Memories, The Way We Were, in this particular instance by Gladys Knight, who I think does a marvellous job on it.
Memories may be beautiful and yet what's too painful to remember. We simply choose to
The Way We Were by Gladys Knight and the Pips. If you could only take one disc out of the 8 you've played, which would it be?
Well, I think it would be That Little Child Singing Tomorrow from Annie, because it's got such optimism, and it would also make me think of my youngest son, Jason. And somehow or other, I'd get off that island and I'd get back to him.
Right. And you're allowed to take one luxury with you to the island, one object of no practical use.
It'd probably be a box of black magic.
A box of chocolates, big box of chocolates.
Yes. Well, why not?
And you're allowed one book. You have the Bible and Shakespeare.
Well, I know it's perhaps an egotistical thing to do, but I think I would take my autobiography, because if I died on the island and whoever found me, that skeleton that would be lying there, at least they'd know in centuries to come who I was and all about me from my autobiography.
Right. And thank you, Diana Dawes, for letting us hear your Desert Island Disc.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.